All righty, before I begin, any questions about Checkpoint Zero? This is the last class before it is due tomorrow. Not started yet. That would be a good time to submit. An hour and a half from now. Yeah.
Summarization.
we take all of the data in a page and we summarize it in a much smaller chunk of information. And then we essentially have this summary page, or as I'm going to start calling it from now on, an index page, that gives us an idea of where the data is on disk that we're looking for. So if we organize the records so that ages, let's say 1 through 23, show up on the first page, then we can basically save that piece of information in one of these index pages and know exactly which page to go to if we're looking for a specific record. So we're looking for, let's say, age, 43, we know that that lives on the second page because the second page contains exclusively records between 23 and 59. So this idea of summary pages saved us quite a bit. We now only load the summary page in as well as the page of data that we're looking for, or the pages of data that we're looking for in order to return a range of values. But we ran into this problem that what if the summary page overflows? And so back in the napkin calculations, we can't even store 10 megabytes of even very simple records, 10 megabytes of summaries of even very simple records on a single index page. So instead, the thought was to start building a hierarchy of summaries. So we build a summary for the first set of pages, we build another summary for the next set of pages, and another summary for the next set of pages. And then we have another index page that points to where each of these the position of each of these second level index pages. So we essentially reinvented a early index structure called an ISAM index, or an index structured access method index, which is basically the first instance that I'm aware of what are called tree index structures, which we'll be focusing on today. Any questions up to this point? Let's say we actually have an index structure built over this. So we've got your index page, a couple of other index pages, a couple of other index pages, each of these points down. Say you have this index structure. How many index pages, or how many pages total are you going to need to load it? Why four? Seems like a rather arbitrary number. One for each level in the hierarchy. Okay, so I drew a very specific index structure. And for this particular index structure, you're going to need to load in more pages. Great. Why four? Why are there four levels in this hierarchy? Put another way, if I give you n pages of data, how many levels of a hierarchy are we going to need in order to store all of that, in order to index all of that data? By the way, I'll do these occasional things where I don't give you all of the information you need. So you're going to have to ask me, what else do I need? Okay, so you need to know the number of records in each page. Let's say that you get number of records in each page or number of records in each, rephrase that question, the number of records in each data page or the number of records in each index page? Index. Okay, so let's say you can hold k references, k records per index page. So how many levels of the hierarchy would we get if we have n pages and k pages per record? Log n to the base k. All right, so at every level of the hierarchy, we're essentially dividing the number of pages by k, right? So we have each one of the each one of these index pages points to k records. Each one of these points to k index pages, so we get k times k. And this points to every one of these, which points to k squared, so we get k cubed. And what's the inverse of exponent? Logarithm. So we need log base k levels in this hierarchy. So constant. So in other words, what we've done is we've taken the index pages, essentially, you improve our performance by a constant factor. That constant factor being log base 2 of k. So this is where databases and classical algorithms diverge. Theoreticians don't really care about constant logarithms. We do. Log base 2 of k actually be a fairly large practice. Okay, questions so far? So one of the last things I asked in class on Tuesday was, what do you do if you have multiple attributes? So in our examples so far, we've been talking exclusively about queries on age. What if I wanted to do a query on age and, let's say, rank? What could I do? Okay, so option one. I could take the same index structure that we built last time and rebuild an entirely second copy of the entire database or the entire data table and organize that by rank. So. So let's grab my little example data here. So let's try that out. Let's say we've got a bunch of data here, right? We want to sort this by rank and then by age. So So, all right, C comes before anything else. We put that first. You've got three different ensigns, all the same rank. So because each of these have the same rank, now we're going to subdivide and sort them within that category by age. So let's say you've got 18, 19, 21. And we're going to sort, say blank space goes before. All right, so we sort first by rank and then by age. And that helps us out a fair bit. This allows us to save a ton of space, certainly. We're only sorting once, and now we're getting two attributes. Advantages? Or actually, first off, any questions about this idea? All right. So what? What are the pros? What are the cons? So yeah, if we're looking for age in this particular example, we need to go to every single group of ranks and rerun the query there. So we're not necessarily saving a whole bunch if we want to query on age. So advantage, it saves a bunch of space. Disadvantage, though, it limits you to the types of queries that you can pose over here. So, maybe I could sort this by age first and then rank, but now I have the exact opposite problem if I want to run a query just over rank. So, okay, we have two strategies so far. Recreate the entire index, recreate the entire index, or use the sort of hierarchical strategy. Great idea last class. You had a great idea. What was it?
I said by sorting if we are dealing with only few attributes instead of storing the entire record and then make this expensive sort of money to the records. Why not separate out the relevant attributes and do the sorting?
Separate the data into two separate chunks, the actual data, and find some way of uniquely identifying every record in the data. You build one index over that, and then you build a second index that just stores the key, and, or the thing that you're looking for, and then the unique identifier. So let's see how that would work in practice here. So we've got our data here. Let's say we've got so you'll note each of these data records has this unique identifier at the front. This first attribute, think of like a Starfleet ID, and there's only one instance of each of these, right? So you've got number one is Ensign Richard, number two is Lieutenant Spock, three is Captain Kirk, and so forth. So instead of storing these full records in your data pages, the suggestion was to just store the thing that you care about, in this case the 19, and the key. that corresponds to that. So we have something like 19, comma, 1, and 3, comma, 2, and 22, comma, 3, and so on. And then you end up sorting all of these. So what you have in the final thing that gets indexed, 18 points record 5. Is that just record 18 points to 5. What's next on our list? 19 points to record 1. 1 and record 4. You get the idea. Now, because we're only storing two specific values, this is going to be a lot more efficient than storing the entire record in terms of space. We can certainly build three records per chunk. So we're going to say in our summary page that here we have 18 to 22, greater than or equal to 18, less than 22. And anything less than 22, or greater than 22, or equal to 22, we go to that page. Okay, great. So, another way. So we build one index normally, and then every index after that, we only store the unique ID of the record. So great. One definite advantage is that this takes up less space. Coincidentally, because this takes up less space, on average, it might actually end up being slightly faster. Because we have to move less data into memory. All right, what else? Is it all good? So we still have indexes on every property, but now they take up a lot less space than recreating the entire table. So definite advantage. Yeah, sure, it still takes up space, but it doesn't, so far of the three options that we've discussed, this takes up the least space while supporting the most queries. So I'll use occasionally pointers to refer to disk pages as well. So you can point to a disk page, you can point to a memory location, as long as it's clear what specifically is being pointed to. And in this case, you can store pointers to a disk page. I'm not sure if that answered your question. The index itself takes the same amount of space, you're correct. But the data page, let me amend that. So what shrinks is the data pages. This takes up a lot less space than this. This is two integers, and a string. You still have to store this somewhere. but in idea number one, you're recreating the entire data set. So you're storing one copy of it organized like this, you're storing one copy of it organized by age, you're storing one copy of it organized by rank, and so forth. Okay, I see the confusion. Let's take the question up to a slightly more general. Let's revisit one particular point. So let's say that you have an index that kind of points to each of these records here. So remember our main argument for, we had two main arguments for kind of breaking our records up into chunks. And the first was that we wanted to, of those two, the most compelling one was that disks already kind of work in this this model of chunks of data. When you read data from disk, it comes, a whole bunch of records come into memory at once. The same thing holds if you're going from memory to cache. You read in not just one record, you read in a whole bunch of records all at once. So in practice, what ends up happening is that these records are going to be stored in chunks. And if I load this chunk in, I'm not just getting Captain Kirk, I'm also getting the Ensign Retro. Now, what that means in practice. Okay, so let's design an index structure that hypothetically follows the pattern that you described. So you are, if I understand correctly, suggesting that we have essentially something like. So actually, in a sense, I think your argument might be the same here, that rather than storing So when you do a binary search over these, you still have to go back to the original data set to figure out which records you're actually interested in, right? So in a sense, this is what we just kind of, this is a very similar structure that you're proposing to the third idea that we just came up with, that rather than storing So in the first idea that we came up with, you do the search directly on the data as it was organized here. And in this third idea, this indirect storing essentially a set of pointers, a set of identifiers, of a way of saying record number one has age 18, record number five has record has age 18. If you're looking for a record with the age of 18, you go to record number five and so forth. Is that? I feel like I might have made things a little more confusing. Okay. Right. So both, I guess both the third and the fourth idea basically follow a similar pattern, a similar flavor. This idea of indirect indexes. If I organize, I keep my data organized according to one pattern, but then I store either, if you want to think of them as pointers or unique identifiers, I can still kind of look up the records that I'm specifically interested in. So that said, well, this is great, this saves us on storage space, but is it all good? There it is. Okay, so how would you add the rank attribute here? Well, so you have one index structure for age. But essentially you have something that says there is a record with the rank of captain, that record has index 3, you have 3 records with the rank of ensign. Let me go back to the other. So you've got your age index here, right? And then you've got a separate one that basically says captain has record five. Ensign record one. Ensign record three. Five. So, and you build obviously a summary over these as well. This brings up an interesting point that that you have these weird boundary conditions that show up sometimes, because there are actually three ensigns, and if we have three records per page, red shirt number, that's in red shirt number five, ends up on the next page. So we have to, the index pages actually have to include a couple of extra bits that say whether the record is uniquely on one side or uniquely, or you need to actually check the next page. But does that address the question? I mean, there's always trade-offs anytime. Yeah. What if we care about more than one attribute at a time? Okay, go on. Okay. strategy more as helpful if we care? So, what do you mean by we care about more than one attribute at a time? Okay, so. So if we have two separate data structures, one for age and one for instance, and we have a query or essentially we're trying to write a script that asks both about the age and about the rank, then we have to pick. We've got two different index structures to work with. It'll help, they'll both help us. They might help us in slightly different ways. And in principle, we could build an index structure that asks for both, or that covers both name and some money. But in general, that's a great observation, that if one query can benefit from both of these, we're going to need to choose which one to use. So this kind of helps us a little bit. It actually creates a whole bunch of other choices that now we can do. We will get back to that in about 2 or 3 weeks. That covers multiple attributes, or you could have two different indexes, each of which cover one attribute, or you could have two different indexes, each of which cover one attribute, and then you just pull out the keys and intersect them. So we're coming up with 3 separate strategies, each of which has different trade-offs, each of which has different strengths and weaknesses. So let's tackle these one at a time, because it's, at the very least, we're not going to go into the actual process of picking between these for another class or two, but we should at least have some sense of what the advantages and disadvantages of each are. So let's say, so what are the 3 that we have? So we can create, one index for each attribute. Individual one attribute indexes, hierarchical indexes, or possibly you need multiple hierarchical indexes. And you can combine these with, so I'm going to I haven't officially defined the term yet, but I'm going to refer to this type of index as a secondary index. So you're, you guys are kind of coming up with great ideas, and we're jumping way ahead before I can pin things down. So an index over a unique identifier we refer to as a primary or a clustered index, because the pattern, the data pages all sit in one place. The data is already sorted according to the same structure that the index follows. So we call this a clustered index, or more commonly in SQL databases, a primary index. Now, here, this secondary index basically points at records in the primary index. So in order to actually look up, let's say, what the name of the person with the name of everyone with an age of 19, in order to do that lookup, you first need to look into the secondary index to find the record ID, and then you need to go back into the primary index to find the actual record itself to get the name. So, call this secondary index. All right, so we've got one index for each attribute. We've got the idea of hierarchical indexes. We've got secondary indexes. And now even within secondary indexes, we've got a couple of different options. So we can combine different secondary indexes, or pick one secondary index get into this in just a moment. So even if we have secondary indexes, we have a couple of different options on how to use the secondary indexes. So let's very quickly go over the pros and cons of each of these. So one index for each attribute. Pro, con, easy, and uses lots of space. Hierarchical indexes. Save space. Still kind of easy, but so you could potentially have multiple hierarchical indexes, but then you kind of start having a trade-off once again. So secondary indexes. We've been talking about a ton of pros. They save space. They not quite as easy, granted, but they certainly save space. They're sometimes faster.
Going to the
Well, So the index itself is helping you in terms of reducing. So you have a couple of options. Let's say you do a query over age. You have a couple of different options in terms of running that query. You could do a full scan through the data set, perfectly legitimate. You could do a binary search over all of the records that were sorted. You could use an index, which is basically like a binary search over the sorted records, but a little bit faster. Now, the idea of a secondary index is you're doing a binary search over data that is a lot smaller. So you're essentially reducing the amount of space that you store to do that first binary search. But the output of that isn't a full record, it's a record identifier. So step one, you get the record identifier. Step two, you go back into the primary index and find the specific records. Yes. So that actually suggests one significant comment. It's less data that you have to bring in, or can be less data that you have to bring in, but at the end of the day, you have to go through two separate index structures in order to get the actual data that you're looking for. So in terms of scalability, it's no more or less scalable than a regular index. In fact, I would argue it's more scalable than having two complete copies of your index. But sure, it's more data to store.
Taking a new second index would be a better option than going one index for every entry.
So I really hate the word better in this class, at least not without saying better under what conditions, or often better. So creating separate indexes for different attributes takes up more space. But it also makes query processing generally faster because you're not loading in quite as much data. And even that comes with caveats, because the secondary index might allow you to use fewer pages on the secondary index, realize that only one tuple actually satisfies your predicate, and you end up actually doing fewer IOs. There's some corner cases in which you might actually end up doing fewer IOs with the secondary index. So rather than saying better, what I want you guys to focus on in this class is what are the trade-offs? Because there's some things that are going to be good in general, but there are going to be cases where they're not as good as another option. And another thing I want you to get familiar with is the fact that there is a huge number of different possible options. And if we have 10 different attributes, we have each of these choices for each of those attributes, or just don't build an index, we have actually 4 different attributes. So that's 4 to the 10th different possible things that we can do. And if we add another attribute, that's 4 to the 11th. And there's a ton of different options. There's no way that a human is going to manually try each and every one of those out. We'll get back to that point later on, but yeah. Under which conditions is a secondary index faster?
Yeah.
So let me give you, so I'm using this kind of as a extreme example. In general, it won't be, but a simple example, a specific example would be, let's say you have a record that is records that are about 1 megabyte apiece. So you have these huge, huge records. And your secondary index is over one specific integer attribute of that index. So you're gonna have a ton of different pages of data. The secondary index, on the other hand, is going to have two integers per record. So if you have a million records, that's 8 bytes, so 8 million. 8 million bytes worth of data, that's just under 10 megs of storage that you need for the secondary index. On many modern versus, what are we talking about? Versus, what did I say, a million records, each 1 meg in size, that's a terabyte of data. So your secondary index is 10 megabytes, your actual data is a terabyte. 10 megabytes you can keep in memory pretty easily. A full terabyte of data, less so. And if the secondary index tells you that only one record satisfies the constraint that you're looking for, that's something that you can get entirely in memory, or almost entirely in memory, depending on what you're trying to do. So I'll admit that's a pretty extreme example, but my point is that these extreme examples do show up in practice, and it's important to understand what the trade-offs are and under what conditions those trade-offs become useful. Yeah?
These secondary indexes, when do we build them?
When do you build them?
When we are talking about age, we're talking about the secondary index for age.
Sure.
When we are asking you for their rank, we are building a secondary index for rank. Are we assuming that we build their secondary index for every attribute and when the user wants it, we get them or when we use it on the client?
That is a fantastic question. So the question is, when in the process do you build an index? And I will give you the same answer I give to a number of different questions that will be asked throughout the class. It depends. So there's a couple of different times when you can build it. You can build it at the very beginning, first load the data. You can build it at some point later on. You can build it, generally you don't want to build it right before the query because the building an index is usually more expensive than just running a query over unindexed data. But even that has some situations where you might want to build an index and then run the query. So the short answer is, it depends on what you need to do, and DBAs get paid a significant amount of money to be able to predict the needs of a database's users, and sit down and basically say, okay, well, I've got this table with 20 different attributes, we're going to need an index on this one, and this one. People have been trying to automate this for decades now. Getting close, but it's still something that you need, at least for the moment, a human to sit down and say, and basically go through this decision space. But one of the things that we will talk about over the course of the term is some tricks for automating the process. I recognize that was maybe not a perfectly satisfactory answer, but does that address your point? All right, we should have taken a break about 15 minutes ago, so let's take a quick 5 minute break. Be back here at 1:35, and we'll go on to we are really short on time. This has been a great discussion. So rather than diving into this, because we're going to come back to it in about 2, maybe 3 weeks, give or take, I'm going to turn this into a question on Piazza. So given a query for two different attributes, where you're interested in both of those conditions being satisfied at the same time, we came up with a couple of different options, picking an index, finding unique identifiers and computing the intersection, using a hierarchical index, if one is available, scanning the full data is a third option, a fourth option that we always have. So between all of these, under what conditions would you want to use one? Under what conditions would you want to use another? Basically, what are the advantages? What are the disadvantages? What are the trade-offs that you need to consider between these different options? So I'll post this on Piazza. Let's move the discussion on this there. In the shorter term, though, before we move on, any questions about this idea of multiple attributes and this idea of secondary indexes? Okay, cool. So the second question I asked you guys at the end of last class was, how do you deal with changing data? Now, remember, we have this, we had these data chunks, and we kind of assumed that each of these chunks was relatively full, that we put as many records into a chunk as we could, and then if we wanted to add more data later, well, we figured we'd talk about that later. It's later now, let's talk. What can we do? So we have these chunks. Each of these chunks is one page. Let's say we have another chunk here that has two pages in it. And in fact, you know what? Let's say that these new records arrive in a batch, that we get a whole bunch of records. They come in one chunk. We can sort it. We can write it to disk. We can do any sort of pre-processing we want. So if we want to merge these two data sets together, how many IOs are we going to need? Eight. Why? so we've got essentially 8 pages worth of data. So it's reasonable to assume that once these all get merged together, we're going to end up with 8 pages of data. Merging doesn't generally make things grow that much. You know, maybe if it's really, really dense, you might end up with 9 pages or something. But you know, in practice, it's a pretty reasonable assumption. Okay, so we read in 6 records here. We read in 2 records there. We produce 8 records as up. Now let's say we get 2 more pages of data. What now?
Can we not use binary search, like this time around, not the fetcher, but for push one?
We use binary search to fetch a record. Okay, so we do a binary search over this, find a position, and then insert the record right here. Okay. You guys are kind of pulling in 2 separate directions. Let's finish one. So let me point out one very quick observation. So far we've been talking about these each of these pages being completely packed, completely full. So we need to reserve a little bit of space for the records. And even if we reserved, let's say, half of the page for new records, there's no guarantee that we wouldn't run out of space if we wanted to do an insertion. Maybe we could do some hacks like a linked list of records following it. But in general, we're going to have to do a little more machination. We're going to have to go through a couple of extra hoops in order to take the approach that you're proposing. We are going to jump through those hoops before the end of next lecture, hopefully before the end of this one. Let's see how this, but I want to see how this pans out, because I wasn't planning on talking about this data structure, but it's a really cool one that I really enjoy. So let's finish this train of thought. Okay, so I've got 2 more pages here. Yeah. There may be many records on one of these. Silly of me, I'm completely skipping over one step here, which is how does this merge even happen in the first place, right? So you've got a bunch of records in here, you've got a bunch of records in here, and they overlap, right? So you might need to take some of the records in this page, some of the records in this page. Page one in your output, let's call this A1. So page C1 is going to have a few records from A1, a few records from B1, right? Random question. Would I expect page C1 to have any records from page A3? Why? So, assuming the records in B1 are in data set B, assuming the records in data sets A and B are sorted, then the very first page of data, you know, the most I'm going to take some records from B1 and kind of insert them into in between the records of A1. So C1 is basically going to be a mishmash of page A1 and B1, right? C2 is going to, you know, yes?
What if this might be an extreme scenario, mm-hmm. but what if AM is not full, and then my B1 datas are coming somewhere in A key place? So maybe when re-engineering the record, it might push some of the A2 record into my A1.
All right, you detail, sure. So the comment is, let's say A1 isn't completely full, you may be able to compact A1 through A3 into a new C1. Okay, sure, you got me. But the point I'm trying to make here is that in order to create C, I need to read in all of A, I need to read in all of B, but I only ever actually need one page of memory from each. I read in one page of A and one page of B, and that allows me to start generating C1. Once I'm done generating C1, I push that out to disk, I create a new chunk of memory, and I start reading in, continuing to read records from A1 and B1. Eventually I'll run out of one of them, and I can read the next page in. If I'm doing what's essentially called a merge of two sorted data sets, I can do that without using up a huge amount of memory. But it's basically going to require one I/O for all of my inputs and one I/O for all of my outputs, right? Assuming that I have more stuff that then can fit in memory, or correspondingly more stuff that can fit than can fit in one cache. So here's a question. Every record in, actually let me back up. That was a bit of a roundabout way of doing it, but has your question been addressed or? Okay, so let's say you go through 10 of these merge steps. So you've got record D, C plus D goes to form E, which has 10 pages in it, and so forth. We go through this whole process 10 times. Here's a question. How many times has record A, have all of the records in A1 been copied? All of them, so all 10 times. So I've read each record in A1 into memory 10 times, and I've written it out to disk 10 times, correspondingly caching this. Now, that is a little bit tricky, because that means that now I need to go through, essentially, as my data grows, as I keep adding more and more data, I'm gonna keep this whole I/O process is going to keep getting worse and worse and worse. So, can we do better? All right. So first off, let me point out one final piece of detail. There's nothing stopping me from creating an index on these. If I have enough records that it makes sense to have an index over D and B, over these kind of temporary storage silos for data, then you know I may as well build an index. Let's say I have two equally sized chunks of data, both with an index over them. And each of these are, let's say, n records. I know that these n records are sorted. I know that these n records are sorted, but I don't know how they necessarily overlap between themselves. What is my cost for accessing this data structure? Say I want to find one specific record. Too long. Okay, So it's a constant factor worse. It's, you know, constant factors aren't great, but 2 isn't huge. And in general, if I store these on separate disks, I can actually execute them in parallel, so that's not necessarily a huge, huge problem. Okay, why do I say this? So, my point here is that this kind of temporary storage, this set of pages that I'm using purely for temporary storage is really, really tiny. Whereas my original data set could be quite large. So let me propose that we only merge together data sets that are equally sized. That we try and as much as possible, only merge together data sets that are equally sized. So how do we get away with that? Well, we've got B, and then along comes a new data set D. So we don't generate C immediately. Instead, we've got B and D, and we merge B and D together to form a new data set with 4 pages. Questions so far? All right, now another data set comes along. Let's say F. So F, once again, has 2 pages. And then we get G, which has 2 pages. And then we merge F and G together. Now we've got 2 data sets, each with 4 pages, and we merge those together. Data set I, which has 8 pages. Now I is about as big as A. We merge those 2 together. Now an interesting thing happens when you start looking at the data structure. So every record in B had to be copied once to create data set E, once to create data set I, and then J, which is A. So every record in B had to be copied once create E, once to create I, and then once to create J. Now compare this to what do we have? 4 new data sets. We would have to copy E. As long as you're still under 2 steps, as long as you're under 4 steps, exponential. But the next time I would have to copy B would be at the eighth chunk of new data. The point at which I'd have to copy B the time after that would be the 16th record. The point I'd have to copy B the next time would be the 32nd record. So rather than copying B every single time I get a new chunk of data, now I'm copying it an exponentially growing number of steps apart. What that means is that rather than copying it a linear number of times, you're going to copy it a logarithmic number of times. So you end up basically with this kind of structure of growing trees, each with an index over it, this is what's known as a log structured merge tree, or an LSM tree. Because you've got essentially a log, these little chunks, each of them is kind of a log, and every time you add more to the log, you merge it together with subsequently larger components of the tree, so they get merged. It's a fun data structure. I will post the original paper and a follow-up paper on Piazza. But this is one way to deal with updates. Fairly efficient. Questions? All right. We will get back on Tuesday to dealing with updates in a completely different way.